5 participants are there. Good evening, children. I hope you have your notes copy for making notes. And we are doing this chapter, Reproduction in Organisms. During these holidays, children, we will be doing those lessons which are comparatively easier. So that's why I have started with this chapter, because most of the portion you are familiar with and you will be easily able to understand. I hope you are able to listen to me. So we are going to start with reproduction in organisms. Reproduction, children, is the process by which an organism is able to produce new organisms of its own type. And in this unit, particularly, first of all, we are going to start with the term lifespan. Lifespan is the period which is from birth till natural death of an organism. So period from birth till natural death of an organism is lifespan. And there is this second statement which says lifespan and size of organism. There is no relationship between lifespan and size of the organism. Lifespan, there are examples where sizes of two organisms are almost same, but their lifespans are very different. We can take examples of crow and parrot. Parrot has lifespan of approximately 80 years to 100 years, whereas a crow, which is of almost same size, has lifespan of around 10 to 12 years. So we can say there is no relationship between lifespan and size of the organism. We can take examples of plants also. In case of banyan tree and mango tree, banyan tree's lifespan is much more than the lifespan of mango tree. This is Amazon parrot. Its lifespan is of approximately 80 years, and crow, which is of same size, that has lifespan of 10 to 12 years. So no relationship between lifespan and size of organism. Then, children, we consider unicellular organisms as immortal. Immortal means which organism which never dies. So why do we consider unicellular organisms as immortal? You can see in this figure that there is one organism which divides to form two organisms. And then this divides to form two, and there occurs, you know, binary division. And every generation, after every generation, there occurs doubling. So what happens when a parent cell divides? It divides to form two daughter cells. As such, no dead body is left. So daughter cells are produced from the parent cell only by division, by its division. So as such, no dead body is left. That is why unicellular organisms are considered as immortal. Ye question ek number mein board mein aata hai. So what is to be written? That we consider unicellular organisms as immortal because reproduction occurs by binary fission. Cell divides to form two daughter cells. As such, no dead body is left. That is why these organisms are considered as immortal. Then let's discuss importance of reproduction. Reproduction helps in production of new generation of individuals to replace those members that die. So we can say this is the process to ensure continuation of the species. And one more thing, if we consider sexual reproduction particularly, there occur variations also. So it is also responsible for variation, for evolution. Evolution, that is because of the variations which are produced as a result of sexual reproduction. Now let's discuss differences between asexual and sexual reproduction. Here you can see two images. One image is of asexual reproduction and the other image is of sexual reproduction. What's the difference? In case of asexual, we see there is parent cell. It divides to form two daughter cells, and daughter cells are exactly similar to that of the parent cell. But in case of sexual reproduction, we see that there are two cells involved. And as a result of involvement of two cells, what happens? Daughter cells which are formed, daughter organisms, these are not exactly similar to parent organisms. Next, let's see this image also. In this image, what do you see? This shows sexual reproduction in animals and plants. So in animals, what happens? There are two organisms, male and female. Female organism has ovaries, and in ovaries, eggs are produced and testes produce sperm. There occurs fertilization, which is fusion of male and female gametes. And as a result of this, a new organism is formed. Then in case of plants, also male and female gametes are produced. So there are pollen grains which are produced. These pollen grains fall on the stigma. And then there is ovary which contains ovum. And after fertilization, and ovule is formed. Children, please mute yourself. Then let's discuss factors responsible for mode of reproduction. There are two factors which are responsible for mode of reproduction. One is habitat or environment of organisms. It is observed generally that organisms which can reproduce both by sexual reproduction and asexual reproduction, in such organisms, during favorable... Children, you are not allowed to write anything on the screen. You can better leave the class if you want to do such things. There are two factors which are responsible for mode of reproduction. One is habitat or environment of organism. This is in case of organisms which can reproduce sexually as well as asexually. It is observed that such organisms reproduce asexually during favorable conditions, but they switch over to sexual reproduction during unfavorable conditions. So we can say environment also affects mode of reproduction. So favorable condition means asexual reproduction, and during unfavorable conditions, organisms reproduce, they switch over to sexual reproduction. And then internal physiology of the organisms. We can see that sexual reproduction is observed in case of simple organisms. And in case of complex organisms like human beings or other animals, mammals, birds, they can reproduce only by sexual reproduction. So we can say there are two major factors responsible for mode of reproduction. Mode of reproduction means whether there is asexual reproduction or sexual reproduction. So environment, in case of favorable environment, there occurs asexual reproduction. and unfavorable environment means sexual. So this factor we can write only in case of those organisms which can reproduce sexually as well as asexually. And in case of higher organisms, there occurs sexual reproduction only. So complex organisms can reproduce only by sexual reproduction. And in case of simple organisms, we can observe both sexual as well as asexual reproduction. Then there are some examples given in your NCERT. First term is clone. Clone means genetically and morphologically identical organisms. So all the organisms which are genetically as well as morphologically identical, those are called clone. So these are produced as a result of asexual reproduction. So we can say organisms which are produced as a result of asexual reproduction are known as clone. And these are genetically identical. And asexual reproduction in case of protista and monera. Children, if you remember protista means unicellular eukaryotic organisms. So amoeba, paramecium, these organisms belong to protista. And in monera, organisms like bacteria, prokaryotic organisms are included in monera. So in case of monera, there occurs asexual reproduction and that is by binary fission. So protista and monera, binary fission. And in case of coelenterata, do you remember example of coelenterata? Hydra. So in case of hydra, we observe budding. So you can write example of coelenterata hydra and then write budding. And in case of yeast also, we observe budding. Then asexual reproduction or reproductive organs in different organisms. In case of sponges, there are internal buds, which are called gemmules. So gemmules are asexual reproductive structures in case of sponges. Gemmules, G-E-M-M-U-L-E-S. And in case of algae and fungi, zoospores are produced. In case of Penicillium, conidia are produced. If you remember, conidia are asexual reproductive structures in case of Penicillium. So let's quickly revise. How does asexual reproduction occur in case of protista and monera? Protista and monera, binary fission. In coelenterata, we can give example of hydra. And in hydra, reproduction by budding. And in yeast also, there occurs reproduction by budding. And in case of sponges, asexual reproductive structures are gemmules. And in algae and fungi, zoospores. And in Penicillium, we write conidia. Then reproduction in organisms. There are some terms like vegetative reproduction. Vegetative reproduction is asexual reproduction in plants. So when we consider asexual reproduction in case of plants, that is called vegetative reproduction. And parts of plants which help in reproduction are known as vegetative propagules. In coming slides, we will see examples of vegetative propagules. And there is one more sentence written here, that is adventitious roots arise only from nodes. Adventitious roots, children, if you remember, are the roots which arise from parts other than radical. So roots which arise from stem, leaf, these are known as adventitious roots. So these can arise only from nodes because nodes are the structures which contain meristematic cells. So these roots never arise from internodes. They arise from nodes because nodes contain meristematic cells. And I hope you know what are meristematic cells. These are cells which are actively dividing cells. So only those cells present in nodes can lead to formation of adventitious roots. Now see some of the examples of vegetative propagules. So in case of potato, first example is potato. You can see in potato there are eyes. From these eyes, new buds are formed. So eyes are in case of potato. Rhizome in case of ginger. You can see small buds in ginger, and from these nodes, these lines which are visible in ginger are called nodes. And from these nodes, new roots are formed, new plants are formed. And this is bulbil. This is bulbil in case of agave. This is bryophyllum. In case of bryophyllum, new plants are formed from the margins of leaf. So these are adventitious buds arising from the margins of leaf. And this is in case of water hyacinth or pistia. These are known as offsets. Offsets. In potato eyes, in ginger, there is rhizome, and this is agave. In case of agave, there is bulbil. This bulb-like structure is known as bulbil, B-U-L-B-I-L. Agave, A-G-A-V-E. And in case of bryophyllum, we see nodes present in the margins of leaf. And these nodes regenerate to form new plants. And in case of water hyacinth, we see these small branches, horizontal branches, and there are nodes present here, and from these nodes we can see roots are formed. So this structure is known as offset. How do we define offset? Offsets are small horizontal branches with nodes, and each node forms a new plant. We can see this structure. You must have seen this plant. This plant is called spider plant. And you can see here at the margin of the, at the tip of the leaf, there are some buds, meristematic cells, and these meristematic cells lead to formation of new plants. I hope you all have seen this plant. This plant is called spider plant. It's in our school also. You can see that at the tip of the leaf, there are nodes, and these lead to formation of new plants. So this structure, this leaf is called vegetative propagule. See this figure. This is example of bulb in case of onion and in garlic. So you can see some bulbs. So these bulbs lead to formation of new plants. Bulb in case of onion and garlic. And this is rhizome in case of ginger. In case of ginger, there are scaly leaves and there are circular nodes. And these circular nodes lead to formation of new plants. So you can see here, new plant is arising from a node. And in case of ginger, example is rhizome. This is agave. I showed you in the first picture agave. Agave mein kya hota hai? Bulbil. So this is in case of agave. Agave has a vegetative propagule named as bulbil. And from bulbil, when this bulbil falls and comes in contact with soil, it leads to formation of new plant. And this is corm, C-O-R-M, corm in case of colocasia, arbi. Arbi pata hoga. Arbi mein kaisa hota hai? You see circular nodes. So these circular nodes bear buds, and from these buds, new plants are formed. So these circular nodes are known as, or the structures which bear these circular nodes are called corm. Runners and stolon. Runner you must have studied in class 11th. So in class 11th, we studied runner. Runners are horizontal branches. And From the, these horizontal branches have nodes, and from each node, new plants are formed. This is runner of mint. In case of mint, also we observe horizontal branches, and from these horizontal branches, new plants are formed. So runner is the vegetative propagule in case of mint. This is stolon. This is again growing horizontally, and from each node, new plants are formed. This is in case of grass. And this is water hyacinth and pistia. Acornia is water hyacinth. In this, what do we see? There are horizontal branches, and from these horizontal branches, new plants are formed. So these horizontal branches with very small internodes, these horizontal branches with small internodes are known as offsets. So offsets are found in pistia and acornia. Acornia is water hyacinth. This is stolon. Children, what is the difference between stolon and runner? In case of runner, branch grows horizontally on the surface. But in case of stolon, what happens? It first grows aerially and then it bends to form, to come in contact with soil. So there is small difference in case of runner. Horizontal branch, it keeps growing on the surface. But in case of stolon, what happens? It first grows aerially above the ground, and then this horizontal branch bends to come in contact with soil, and then it forms a new plant. Then what does this image show? You see these this image is taken from it's near Hindon River, and you must have seen this green plant. This is water hyacinth. Water hyacinth is also known as terror of Bengal. Why is this plant known as terror of Bengal? Because this plant was actually introduced in India because of its beautiful purple colored flowers. What happens? Its rate of growth is very fast. It grows very rapidly. So what happens when it grows? Then it covers whole surface of water. And when it covers whole surface, then what happens? Air supply is cut off. You know that solubility of oxygen is less in water. And aquatic organisms, they depend on oxygen which is dissolved in water. So what happens when air supply is cut off? Then aquatic organisms die because oxygen supply is cut off. They don't get enough oxygen. And because of deficiency of oxygen, those dead organisms, they decompose anaerobically. So because of anaerobic decomposition of dead organisms, what happens? Water body gets highly polluted. So this plant is why called terror of Bengal. And it is very serious problem. It grows very rapidly and causes, you know, death of water body, aquatic organisms in water bodies. It chokes water bodies to death. Then you see this image. In this image, what can we see? It shows events of sexual reproduction. So there is one female gamete, which is egg, and male gametes are called sperms. These fuse to form zygote, and then zygote divides to form embryo, and embryo forms a new organism. So here we can divide this whole process in three events. One is pre-fertilization, and then second is fertilization, and third is post-fertilization. So we can divide sexual reproduction in three events: pre-fertilization, fertilization, and post-fertilization. Pre-fertilization involves gametogenesis and gamete transfer. Gametogenesis means formation of gametes. So formation of egg or sperm is known as gametogenesis. And gamete transfer, like in case of plants, what happens? Pollen grains are transferred to stigma. So they can be artificially transferred. There can be wind pollination. There can be insect pollination. So gamete transfer is required. So pre-fertilization involves two events, gametogenesis and gamete transfer. And fertilization, it involves fusion of male and female gametes. And what about post-fertilization events? Post-fertilization events involve embryogenesis. Embryogenesis means formation and development of embryo. Then there are two terms, juvenile phase and vegetative phase. Juvenile phase term is used in case of animals and vegetative phase term is used in case of plants. So what happens in case of sexual reproduction or in case of higher organisms which reproduce sexually, organisms have to, they have to grow to a particular age when they become mature enough to be able to reproduce. So that period of growth and maturation is known as juvenile phase in case of animals and vegetative phase in case of plants. So it's the phase of growth and maturation when organism becomes, it becomes mature to be able to reproduce. So that phase is known as phase of growth is known as juvenile in case of animals and vegetative in case of plants. And then reproductive phase is the phase when organism is able to reproduce. So that phase is known as reproductive phase. And senescent phase is the phase of growing old. So we can divide an organism's life in three parts, three phases. One is pre-reproductive phase. Pre-reproductive phase is the juvenile phase in case of animals and vegetative in case of plants. And reproductive phase when organism is able to reproduce. And senescent phase can be considered as post-reproductive phase when organism is not able to reproduce and organism is growing old. And then children, see this second statement very carefully. Second statement is in case of perennial plants, it's very difficult to define all the three phases. What is this? This is very important. This comes as, for justification in your board exams. This is very important. So what happens in case of perennial plants? If you remember what are perennial plants, because there are three types of plants we can broadly classify. Annual plants are plants which can complete their life cycle in within 1 year. So we observe all three phases in this 1 year. We observe pre-reproductive phase, then they reproduce, and then we observe senescent phase also. They complete their life cycle in 1 year. So in case of annual plant, we can easily see three clear-cut phases. We can observe pre-reproductive, reproductive, as well as post-reproductive. And then there are biennial plants. Biennial plants are the plants which have lifespan of 2 years. So it is observed that during the first year, they grow and they mature and then they are able to reproduce. And in second year, they produce seeds, fruits, and then we observe post-reproductive phase. So in case of biennial plants also, we observe three clear-cut phases like pre-reproductive, reproductive, and senescent phase. But what about perennial plants? Perennial, like mango is perennial plant. Mango ka lifespan kareeb 12 years ka hota hai. So this is perennial plant and it is seasonal. So what happens? Fruits come in particular season. So why is this very difficult to define all the three phases? Ab ek mango plant mein is saal fruit production hua. Next season mein phir fruit production hoga. So what about the period which is between two consecutive flowering? Ek is season mein flowering hogi, ek next year mein flowering hogi. So what about the period which is between two consecutive flowerings? Period which is after after first flowering can be considered as post-reproductive for first flowering, but can be considered as pre-reproductive for coming flowering period. So what happens? Period between two consecutive flowerings cannot be, you know, that can be considered as post-reproductive for first flowering and pre-reproductive for next coming flowering. So it's difficult to define three phases in case of perennial plants. And there are some plants which show unusual flowering phenomena. One example is given of bamboo in your book. Bamboo shows unusual flowering because it flowers once in its lifespan. Its lifespan is of approximately 50 years and it flowers only once in its lifetime. So this flowering is considered as unusual. And then another example is of Strobilanthus kuntiana, which is known as Nila Kurenji. This plant flowers every 12 years. So in this case, what happens? Why do we consider this unusual? In most of the cases, there is seasonal flowering. Ek particular season mein flowering hoti hai. But in case of Strobilanthus kuntiana, flowering is after every 12 years. And then there are two terms, seasonal and continuous breeders. Seasonal breeders are the breeders which breed in a particular season. Like, you know, most of the wild animals, they are seasonal breeders. And continuous breeders, human beings are examples of continuous breeder which can reproduce any time of the year. So there are two terms, seasonal breeders, birds or animals which are found in wild conditions are known as seasonal breeders. And continuous breeders are the breeders which can reproduce any time during the year. And then mode of reproduction in primates and non-primates. Children, primates are monkeys, human beings and apes. So in case of primates, and it's not given in detail in your book, so you are not supposed to describe this in detail. You just need to write about the cyclical changes which occur in uterus. So you write, in primates, there occurs menstrual cycle, and in non-primates are other mammals, like camel, cow. In these mammals, non-primate mammals, what happens? There occurs estrous cycle. What is the difference between menstrual cycle and estrous cycle? In case of menstrual cycle, you know, if fertilization does not take place, then uterine lining is, it comes out as menstrual fluid. But in case of estrous cycle, in case of non-primates, that degenerated lining that doesn't come out as menstrual fluid, it gets reabsorbed in the body. So this is the basic difference in mode of reproduction in primates and non-primates. In your book, this menstrual cycle and estrous cycle is given. So there is only one point that is to be written in case of mode of reproduction in primates and non-primates. And then gametogenesis. Children, we have already discussed gametogenesis is the process of formation of gametes. And here only terms need to be defined. Then isogametes means all the gametes which are morphologically similar. When we are not able to make difference between male and female gamete, there is no morphological difference, then gametes are called isogametes. And we have discussed this in class 11th, isogamous, oogamous and isogamous. So isogametes are gametes which are of same type, which are morphologically similar. And heterogametes means when male gamete is, in case of most of the organisms, male gamete is small and female gamete is large, egg is very large. So this condition is known as heterogamete. Then we are also familiar with homothelic. If you remember in class 11th, we studied rickettsia. In rickettsia, homothelic means enthyridium and archegonium are present on same thallus. And heterothelic is Markensia. Heterothelic is bar board exam mein aaya hai. Heterothelic ka example, Markensia. We studied in class 11th. Markensia is heterothelic. Enteridia and archegonium are present on different thalli. Then monoecious means bisexual. Male and female reproductive organs are present on same organism. And dioecious or unisexual means male and female organisms are different. So children, you need to learn examples like human beings are unisexual, earthworm is bisexual. Aise hi plants mein papaya is unisexual. Rose or China rose, you have seen China rose, that is bisexual. So you need to learn examples. And then staminate flower and pistillate flower, you are also aware of this, these two terms. If flower is unisexual, then flower has either male reproductive part or female reproductive part. If plant flower has female reproductive part, it is known as pistillate flower. And if flower has male reproductive part, it is known as staminate plant flower. Then examples of monoecious and dioecious plants, children, you need to learn. Then hermaphrodite condition is the condition when, it is a bisexual condition. So earthworm is known as hermaphrodite because it has male and female reproductive organs both. Snail is an example of hermaphrodite. So you can give two examples, snail or earthworm. These are hermaphrodite. Hermaphrodite means bisexual organism. And gamete production in haploid and diploid parent. Children, we studied this in class 11th when we did life cycles. So in case of haplontic life cycle, what happens? Parent is haploid and gametes are also haploid. So these gametes are produced by mitotic division. Here we are supposed to write about the division. So in case of haploid parent mein gamete production kaise hoga? By mitotic division, because mitosis is the division in which chromosome number remains the same. And if the parent is diploid, just in case, take an example of human beings. So parent is diploid, has 46 chromosomes and gametes are formed by meiosis. That is why gametes have half number of chromosomes. Then meiocytes. Meiocytes are the cells which divide to form gametes. These are cells which divide meiotically to produce gametes. So ploidy means whether they are haploid or diploid. So in case of diploid parent, meiocytes are diploid. And in case of haploid parents, these are haploid. And gametes are essentially haploid. So ploidy of meiocyte is diploid and gametes are haploid. And you can imagine number of male gametes produced is several thousand times the number of female gametes produced. This is because male gametes are always released in environment. You can take examples of pollen grain. So pollen grains kya hota hai? Environment mein release ho gaya. Wind se or insect se wo female gamete tak pahunchenge. So to increase the chances of fertilization, they are always produced in large number. Ki hawa se udke kuch to female gamete tak pahunchenge. So to increase chances of fertilization, number of male gametes is always several thousand times the number of female gametes. And gamete transfer in simple plants like algae, bryophytes and pteridophytes is by water. Water is the medium of gamete transfer in algae, bryophytes and pteridophytes. Pollination means transfer of male gametes, pollen grains onto stigma. And pollination is very important for fertilization. The importance of fertilization mein kya likhoge? Pollination mein importance of pollination, it is essential for fertilization. And fertilization is fusion of male and female gametes. There is one more term, let's discuss quickly, parthenogenesis. Parthenogenesis is formation of new organisms without fertilization. Formation of new organisms without fertilization. This is observed in case of animals. In case of honeybee, we observe that males are produced without fertilization. So this phenomena is known as parthenogenesis. Don't get it confused with parthenocarpy. Parthenocarpy is formation of fruit without fertilization. And parthenogenesis is formation of new organism without fertilization. Parthenocarpy, formation of fruit without fertilization. and parthenogenesis, formation of new organism without fertilization. Children, please revise this chapter from your